Hello. So, welcome to Why Did the Spanish Empire Collapse? You always ask me about stuff about Spain because of Gibraltar. I don't know. I have no idea. I'm not a historian. I'm just a guy behind a computer screen who knows nothing.
To be fair, you do know a lot of history, so I
No,
won't
I do
ask you.
not.
He does.
No
He's not
idea.
giving himself credit, he does.
No.
Yes.
No.
Shoot your balls.
Okay. Anyway, it depends what the history's about. If it's about ancient history, then I might be okay. If it's not, then I'm not okay.
Current history, probably not so much, but ancient Egypt, you know very much a lot. Ancient Rome, Greece.
Yeah, I mean, it's not difficult. Just they're all degenerates. They're
You're
all sadists, and they were all crazy.
crazy to them, crazy to you. What's the difference?
They're all crazy.
They didn't think they were crazy. They thought they were modern.
They were not modern.
I mean, they did give kids, what was it the one time? They give kids meth at one point for a cold.
No
Yeah.
way.
They used to rub asbestos on their faces, like.
And then wonder why they're all dead.
Yeah.
Anyway, so, well, actually, how would they know about them? Whatever, someone in the comments would be like, oh, freak out. How would they know back then? It's like they wouldn't know, that's the thing.
They definitely learned in the end then.
Yes. Anyway, so should we begin?
Yeah.
The Spanish Empire,
So long,
also
John.
known throughout
Oh, sorry,
history
special
as
thanks
the
to him.
Hispanic
Oh,
Monarchy,
so
was
this video is done by Knowledgia. These were his sponsors.
at
Well,
one
not
time
sponsors,
what
Patreon, sorry, I'm assuming. So long, John. Hello, So long, John.
one of the largest empires to
Euph
ever
It's a euphemism, by the way.
Oh, goodness gracious.
exist. The Spanish Empire was fairly
Conquistadors.
unique in its structure, and it boasted colonial overseas territories across the Americas, Asia, Africa, and Oceania. During its peak, the monarchy even became known as the empire on which the sun never sets.
Ha!
So how did
That we took that title. The UK did take the title.
I know.
But the Spain was always massive. Like, the Spanish Empire was huge. Look at this, spanning two continents. Look at this.
I know.
And then this.
And over there.
And this. It's interesting.
Did a powerful force such as the Spanish Empire collapse after centuries of dominating land around the
That's
globe?
a good point, how?
This video is brought to you by
Oh,
Curiosity
that's why
Stream,
it
as there.
collapsed.
Curiosity collapsed it?
No. Yeah,
Anyway,
well, actually,
probably
hey,
was
I
Curiosity
get
that
that.
collapsed
Yeah.
it.
Anyway, please watch the original video and please go give him all the credit. Yes, so I'll move on to the next
Part.
part.
Jesus.
Documentaries is The Real War of Thrones. In this one, you can see how
Oh,
power-hungry
we're still in
dynasties
the.
fought for the
My
domination.
bad, we're still in the adverb. There we go. See, everyone else skips to this bit. Hey, let me go back a bit.
Legia, and you will get your
More
first 30
Legia.
days of Curiosity Stream completely free.
I just Google
The
it.
creation of this monarchy may have foreshadowed its later decline into extinction. In 1469, Ferdinand of Aragon and Isabella of Castile married. Despite coming from modest backgrounds that forced the young couple to use loans simply in order to afford their wedding ceremony. Overcoming the obstacle of finances that would later plague and doom their now budding empire, the 18 and 17-year-old monarch's union marked an important pillar for the foundation of the Spanish monarchy.
I don't know if you knew this, a lot of Spain was once ruled by a vast Muslim majority.
I did not know that.
It like spread it up to here, I believe. Like this.
That's insane.
Yeah, it is insane. It went up to there, and then Spain sort of came together and just pushed them out. I don't know much about it, but I'd be interested to learn about it at some point.
While the marriage formed a personal union between Aragon and Castile and united the economic, religious, and military aspects of their joined Iberian territory, it did not form a totally unitary style of authority spanning over all of the empire's claimed possessions. In fact, the monarchy did not fully take on the structure of an empire until the Spanish Habsburgs came to power at the start of the 16th century.
It's true. try that.
And this formation was further solidified by the Spanish Bourbon rulers later on. The monarchy...
Sorry, I did that because it was flickering in my eye.
How the sun came out again.
It was difficult to be interested in the history when I'm going, oh my god, hello. Like,
sorry, sunglasses.
The personal union. The personal union. Ah, fuck, I'm blind.
sunglasses weren't bent yet, you don't care.
But I want the sunglasses.
Get them.
I actually look pretty good in them.
Yeah, it's cool.
Under Ferdinand and Isabella was fairly admirable and a solid start for the new formed union. Many governmental reforms, such as the judicial system and tax administration, brought about remarkable improvements, as did the abolishment of serfdom, updated infrastructure, and other changes made by the young leaders. This foundation was not as bad as one might expect from an empire that collapsed as the Spanish did. Nevertheless, the decay of the large European power began long before the inevitable fall itself. The main problems were the poor decisions made by Spanish governments during the decades.
Okay.
Spain was a global superpower, and as other big empires, the external threat wasn't the main issue. In a case of military defeat, such an empire will not crumble if everything was in order at home. The biggest problem for the Spanish Empire started from within. Around the middle of the 16th century, Spain's economy at home was starting to struggle.
That's hot.
Overseas, in contrast, the empire was still on a wave of vast expansion, and had not yet hit a rut in that regard.
You heard of the conquistadors and Aztecs, Incas, and all that stuff?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. We've all seen Scooby-Doo.
That's actually where I learned from.
Oh, is it? That's insane, actually.
Then I googled it after Scooby-Doo.
Oh, you googled it just to see what happened.
I mean, I didn't trust all Scooby-Doo's history.
Obviously. Yeah, like, there's this giant hairy man chasing you.
I didn't know Spain had those.
In the rainforest. Oh, God.
I didn't know Spain had those.
Giant hairy men?
In the rainforest, I didn't know. And, and Scooby-Doo is purple, too.
Well, I was going to say, Spain has giant hairy men, but it's British tourists visiting.
Just, probably more European than you, though. No. Yeah, it's probably more like the French and the German there.
No, there's a stupid amount of like Brits that go to Spain every year.
I know, but I'm just saying the hairy ones on the trips when everyone went to Japan were the French guys and the Germans, and they need soap. Backpackers this really need to get soap.
We learned that in Japan.
It makes the rest of us look bad.
I'm just saying, we chose to go to Japan, and I was pushing for it a lot because I didn't want to be that next person to say, yeah, I've been to Spain. Because, like, I'm not trying to be rude. Every single British person has been.
I've been to Spain.
I haven't.
It was only a day trip. I've been to
Would Spain. I would like to go? Yeah, I'd like to go.
To be fair, I had an emergency landing, got stuck in Spain. But I was in Spain.
Yeah, he was in Spain.
I was there for a long time. Christmas Eve, exactly.
I'd like to go, but the idea that so many people have been there, and you can't even make a conversation starter out of it. Oh, I've been to Spain. Oh, wow, which part did you go to? Oh, I went to Barcelona. Oh, that's amazing. I went to Castile. It's like...
Barcelona's cool, though. You should check it out.
Oh, yeah, that's where you landed, right?
Mm-hmm.
I want to go to Barcelona.
It was really cool.
I do want to go.
Hey, most airport staff is not helpful. They were helpful. They chucked me in a bus.
That's nice of them, actually.
Yeah, the red bus.
At least in Germany, you just go travel to the middle of Germany, and it's like...
For COVID test, but they didn't tell you what taxi takes, bus system, in the middle of COVID. And it's like, where do you want me to go?
Cheers, thanks, guys. Thanks.
They directed me to a bus to go get food at a restaurant, because they said it was good food. It was good food.
Was it good food?
Oh, it was amazing.
Oh, amazing food. Okay. Well, that's kind of the food.
Still, back in Europe, things were not going so well. Expansion-wise, the empire was doing quite all right. With Charles V seizing the throne, the empire was technically expanded without the use of military conquest. Over southern Italy, Austria, the Netherlands, and the Holy Roman Empire.
Wow.
But pretty yet spotty. Somehow, despite this really superficial success, the economy was in a decline.
I'm just saying, if you're going to take land, you should make it a big mass land, because spots is not a good idea.
Like, did the Spanish lawmakers say, let's play connect the dots?
I mean, I get why. I can't see where they start to crumble, though, because they didn't take mass land, they took spots.
Yeah, fair one. No, yeah.
I kind of can see where it's starting to crumble.
I'm just saying, the Holy Roman Empire is a big, well, state.
It's like the upper spot where Spain took, that looks like it'll be safe because they can protect that. But the smaller spots, I feel like people can invade those easily.
And even Italy.
Yeah.
One theory as to why this odd contradiction existed lies in the laid-back approach that the empire took in managing its overseas possessions. While the new colonial territories of the Spanish Empire provided new opportunities for the exploitation of natural resources and for trade around the world, the empire was lax with its subjects and did not ask for much.
Okay.
What they did ask for, such as a share of their colony's mining earnings, in addition, was often withheld. Furthermore, the Habsburgs had hoped to maintain a state monopoly and closed mercantile system, but more or less failed. Instead, they set up their empire for economic hardship. In an attempt to counteract their rapid fall behind the industrial and economic progress of their Dutch, English, and French European neighbors, the Spanish Empire began to allow and almost embrace illicit commercial activity that had any potential to bring in money for the crown.
Okay.
During the reign of Charles V, military conflict with France, the Ottomans,
So
and
it's like in the UK, if a crack dealer was making loads of money, then the government would be like, "Oh, give me some of that."
Don't rest, I'm just thinking. I think that his one big downfall is that he was relaxed with them.
Really? Well, yeah, I think.
You can't be relaxed with your lands. During that time, at least you couldn't.
True. I mean, most empires just stomp on the subjects, don't they? I don't know much about Spanish rule, so I'm not going to rule out any
No, but I'm just
conclusions or anything. But,
you can't be very relaxed on it.
No.
Because then, see how the fights all started? It's like,
So you sort of need to be forceful for a little while.
It's, I think back in the day, rulers had to be a little bit aggressive.
A little bit violent.
A little bit of violence is the way to keep rule.
You always tell me violence isn't key, and I'm like, it is key.
Back in the day, it was key. It's not like key now. Like, you know how much danger there would be if you brought violence into things? It's
Yeah,
not
it
like they're just
is.
gonna come at you with a sword. They're gonna come at you with a big nuke. Think about it for a minute.
You bought a nuke to a sword fight.
Yeah, like nowadays you can't threaten other countries.
Well, you bought a knife to a
Yeah.
nuke fight.
Can't do that. Back in the day, what are they gonna do? Come at you with their sword? Like, it's not that bad.
Oh my god.
Are they threatening with the horse? Like,
Hooked on horse!
it's not like they could cause mass damage easily.
Well, actually, the Mongols did, slinging their horses over
Yeah, that's true.
over the city walls in what do you call it? Begins with T. Is it Jaffa? Jaffa, JAFA, where that's where the Black Plague, they believe, sort of started pouring into Europe, because the Mongols launched plague victims over the walls as well as their rotting horses.
Yes, they actually did that. Yes, that's a thing. It was gross.
Oh, what a lovely day outside. Out on horse!
Oh, that's your granny one!
All right.
German
We won't
states
survive long in the
drained the Spanish fund drastically. The emperor became desperate, having to take loans from German and Genoese banks. Meanwhile, hoping to tax his subjects more to try and recover the lost finances.
Ooh, bad idea.
While he originally turned to the Netherlands and Italy with these taxes, he was unable to maintain them for long, and eventually had to target Spain itself.
Ooh.
This caused more damage at home, as Spain's taxes were hiked, and Castile took the brunt of it. Part of this new tax structure included the alcabala, which differed from a normal sales tax, as it could be applied to any transaction at any point in the process of a product moving to market and afterward. It also put a 10% tax on the transfer of all property, personal or otherwise, and all assets. The system was self-destructive, and many notable figures within the empire, such as Cardinal Ximenes, even attempted to convince Emperor Charles to remove the harmful taxation. But due to the revenue it brought in, the monarch refused, and even added more taxes, including the Cruzada, the Terces, and the Servicio.
Okay.
This plan began to implode on itself, as the increased taxes also sparked an increase in tax evasion. Some tax gatherers would even be murdered, while other citizens simply found more subtle means of avoiding payment. Many farmers began to emigrate to the Americas in a desperate attempt to avoid the draining taxes. Others realized that government employees were free of taxes, which caused a skyrocket in the number of such workers.
Oh, that's violent.
One Spaniard even wrote that there were 1,000...
You're telling me the government workers didn't have to pay taxes. Can you imagine the farmer found out that the guy didn't have to pay taxes and they just came to his house with a pitchfork?
Yeah, but it did happen a lot.
I'm just saying, violence was coming out key.
It's a bit like in the talk shows, wherever they talk, when they talk about what they do for a living, and you know that one person who doesn't want to say tax man. Or tax woman.
You really want to tax your farmers, though. You think about it, you really shouldn't tax... If you tax your politicians and stuff, but not your...
Tax them to fuck.
But your farmers, you kind of need them for a living, you know?
Yeah, yeah, for sure.
It's not like they got Walmart down the road, like... They kind of need the farmers. They didn't think this through.
The Spanish Empire would collapse if they had Walmart.
Employees, where 40 would suffice.
10% off an assault rifle.
Even wrote that there were 1,000 employees, where 40 would suffice. Noblemen were also exempt from many taxes, prompting other desperate peasants to join their more underground lifestyle. By the end of Charles' time as emperor, the region of Aragon in particular was actually paying fewer taxes than it had before the new system was implemented. As if this new predicament wasn't enough to shake the empire's foundation, the Spanish monarchs were now also faced with the challenge of a Dutch revolt in their Netherland colony. The Dutch were furious with the Spanish Empire for neglecting both their needs and problems, and for implementing some of the new damaging taxes from Spain, now in the Netherlands as well. In addition, there was the factor of rising Protestantism, particularly Calvinism, in the Netherland region, that directly conflicted with the Spaniards' strong Catholicism.
Yeah, religion.
This revolt sparked a war not just between the Dutch and the Spanish, but even more so between the Spanish and the French, who were eager to join anyone in a campaign against Spain. This war was expensive and long-lasting. The Dutch did gain full autonomy from the Spanish Empire in 1581 as the Dutch Republic, but conflict between the now competing powers continued deep into the 17th.
This caused a divide later in history, I guarantee you.
I think that role is probably one of the worst ones for their history at this point.
I mean, we don't know much about him.
Well, he just seems like an ass.
Yeah, fair one.
He just taxes the poor people, the farmers, and then the nobleman's like, nah, I don't need taxes.
Where have we heard this before?
Yeah, we should really take... we should remember the saying, we should repeat history. I think we need to go back to Spanish history and say, let's not repeat history.
Yeah. What was the architecture like in Barcelona?
Beautiful.
Was it?
Very beautiful.
Is it like sandstone?
It's very pretty. You got pictures of it. I don't know what it's called, but it's very, very pretty.
Okay.
Don't know what it's called, but it was gorgeous.
Well, I want to visit Spain, like Barcelona, so we'll have a look.
I took pictures, you can see them.
Hmm?
I took pictures, you can see them. They're pretty. I was only there for a day, and then I had to fly out to England, so, you know. And it was really pretty sunny weather, too.
Massive downgrade.
Rain.
Massive downgrade.
It was beautiful, though.
8th century. As taxes continued to rise, so did tensions and dissatisfaction within the empire.
Okay.
In 1640, Portugal, which had only been united with Spain in 1580, erupted into rebellion and eventually declared its own independence from the Spanish Empire. This jolted the European holdings of the Spaniards, and many more of their semi-autonomous territories began threatening their own revolts. And some regions throughout Italy, Flanders, and France even broke free. Adding fuel to the already raging fire, the new issuance of copper coins triggered inflation in 16...
Okay, super quick.
Okay.
All right, there you go.
1641,
which was counteracted with a messy anti-inflationary reform the following year. At this time, as stated by a French envoy to Spain, it would be difficult to describe to its full extent the disorder in the government of Spain. By the 18th century, the Bourbon monarchs, who replaced the Habsburgs when they were unable to produce another heir, attempted to mend the issues arising within their empire, but they were undermined by their own thirst for war and further expansion. At this point, Protestantism was spreading like wildfire, and the Spaniards were inspired to fight back in the name of Catholicism, as well as feeling compelled to directly oppose the Ottoman Empire's advances, as they too hoped to expand their influence. This uptick in warfare cost money, and the Spanish Empire lacked a surplus of finances. Hoping to counteract this problem, the Bourbon monarchs aimed to re-establish a Spanish monopoly, as had been attempted before, but they were stopped by the terms of the Treaty of Utrecht in 1713, which ended the War of Spanish Succession. The empire tried to offset this blockade by rolling out strict new trade and commerce reforms, both at home and overseas, which eventually sparked a war with the British in the late 1700s, demonstrating the never-ending...
So, like, back then, the British and the Spanish were rivals, like, literally rivals to the death, but they couldn't destroy each other.
They're both too powerful.
No, whenever they tried, it just didn't work. Portugal would side with the UK or British Empire.
Are they our oldest ally?
They are, yes. They are our oldest ally, and back then, even when they were very, very powerful, they were also pretty much on the hip of the British.
Yeah.
Basically, they were our back door into Spain.
Which is dangerous for poor Spain.
Yeah, and France was Spain's back door into us.
Makes sense.
So it was just a cycle.
And you and friends didn't go.
Chaos that had been created. Some local political writers even recognized the growing monetary problems and sent letters to the crown, suggesting that royal expenditure must be regulated, the sale of office halted, the growth of the church checked. The tax system must be overhauled, special concessions must be made to agricultural laborers, rivers be made navigable, and dry lands irrigated. Furthermore, the authors even pointed out directly the empire's humiliating dependence on foreign nations, but it was too late. Because of these internal problems, the territories of the Americas were pretty much neglected, as they were a very good stream of gold and silver, and not a territory to be more populated and incorporated more under Spanish authority. The Spanish administration in the Americas was inferior to the English administration, as the new English and later British territories had a rapid growth in population, due to liberal immigration policies attracting large proportions of German and French people. Meanwhile, the Spanish territories had a slow growth, due to greater emphasis on military conquest, many early failures to establish permanent settlements, and poor relations with Native Americans. At the start of the 19th century, Napoleonic France invaded Spain, and this was the fire that sparked the revolutions in the Americas. The other vice royalties rebelled, as their home nation was too weak to have the reins, and it was clear that Spain was just a shadow of its former self. The revolutions had success, and it was clear that Spain wasn't able to fight them. In just a few years, they lost almost all of their American possessions.
Wow.
And at the end of the 19th century, after the Spanish-American War, they lost Cuba, Puerto Rico, Guam, and the Philippines, marking the official end of the empire. The sole reason for the collapse of the
Wasn't it a false flag war? As in, it was caused by America to invade those islands?
I think so. I'm just saying, they got hit by France, and I know where the other ones hit them at the same time. That's just awful.
That's insane, isn't it?
No wonder they
It's such a fast collapse. I wonder if there's still trauma today. Not being funny, I wonder if there's still trauma today.
Yeah, that's insane.
The Spanish Empire was essentially ill management by the monarchs, and possibly overconfidence.
Because some one person in the comments would be like, obviously not, because everyone's dead by then. No, what I mean is like, society and structural.
Yeah.
Because there's still, like, trauma from that time period in other countries. That's what I meant.
...of their ability to maintain stable colonial territories. In less simple terms, money, or lack thereof, and poor judgment, played a hugely significant role in the humiliating fall of an empire with so much potential at its start. Still, finances were not on the side of the Spaniards, and it seems that, somehow, the foreshadowing of Ferdinand and Isabella's wedding would come to life in spite of every desperate reach to overcome it.
It's crazy.
Well, thank you for watching, guys. Please go and give Norligia the support. It's his video, his created, he created everything for it. Well, apart from him and his team, there you go. I hope you enjoyed the video. We thought we'd try Spain. We thought we'd try why did the Spanish Empire collapse. I thought it was a very interesting video.
It was interesting, actually.
Me and Julie both didn't know much about Spain to begin with, if anything.
I know a little bit.
So, yeah, we'll see you in the next video. Thank you for watching. Goodbye.
Let's go. Time to grind. Get inside your mind. Yeah, we working overtime. That's the only way to climb. We gon' make it in.